gift to look good on you.
You were born with a grace.
Huh. The gift that looks good on you.
That grace is your gift.
Yeah. The gift that looks good on you.
It's a divine enablement.
The gift that looks good on you.
If you work the grace will work for you. Company, teach the lesson.
The systems of the world
systems
will try to take your confidence.
Yes, they will.
For these systems were designed to make you doubt what heaven said.
Don't you doubt.
The systems of the world
these systems
will try to take your confidence.
Jesus Christ. Feel free to sit back and sing along, clap your hands, pat your feet, but most importantly, give all the glory and honor to our Lord and Savior, for as we celebrate the birth of Jesus, because He is a wonderful child. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he shall not depart from it. As we continue to spotlight our young adults who receive spiritual training here at Second Baptist Church, it is such a blessing to see our future leaders transform into gifted, God-fearing young adults. We are honored to hear the great accomplishments they are making in their lives. So today, let's welcome our spotlight of the day, Sky Leonard.
Hi everyone, my name is Sky Leonard. I am a junior attending Central State University. I am majoring in business administration with a concentration in agribusiness. I am the daughter to Summer Doxy and Carl Leonard, and I am the one and only grandchild of Norma Leonard Andrews. My favorite scripture would have to be Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3. It states, "You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you." And I just love this verse so much because it's just a little reminder that as long as I trust in God, as long as I put him first, he can always give me the peace that I need to get through the days and get through the years. And my words of encouragement to the youth would simply be to stay focused on your goals. Don't let anything distract you from what's important. You have to think about the long run. You can get through anything as long as you put God first. It's so important to find that peace that God provides you. And as long as you have a relationship established, you're building a relationship with him, God will come through and just do what he needs to do in your life to just make sure that you get everything that you desire and everything that you want.
Good morning, Second Baptist. Your announcements for today are as follows. The COVID vaccine is on the way. However, the pandemic and the virus are still here. Be safe, social distance yourself, wear a mask, and avoid crowds. The food pantry on Wednesday, December the 23rd, will be serving in the parking lot adjacent to the church. Register and simply drive through. Register and simply drive through. That's Wednesday, December the 23rd. Services for Second Baptist Church are as follows. As you can see now, we stream every Sunday morning at 11 a.m. Starting Wednesday, January the 6th, Bible study will resume. Sunday schools are as follows. Adult Sunday school can be found teleconference Saturday at 10 a.m. and Sunday at 9 a.m. We will have a youth Zoom Sunday school Christmas program. Will be Zoom Sunday, 12:20. That's Sunday this Sunday at 10 a.m. Leaders of Tomorrow will meet once a month, times and dates varying. Please see our website page for further instructions on how to teleconference and how to Zoom. Following this service, this Sunday and every Sunday, we will have an hour of power. Every Sunday from 12:30 to 2, we will have an hour of power. 343-0073 is the number to call for the hour of power. We will have prayer for the sick and shut in every Sunday from 12 to 2 for our hour of power. If you are simply in the need of prayer, 343-0073 for our hour of power every Sunday. If you want to join our flock or simply join our congregation, you can call 343-0073 during our hour of power every Sunday from 12 to 2. Or if you want to call sometime during the week, Monday through Friday, 10 to 2, you can call us 343-0073. Or if you had questions and you simply wanted to email the church, you can email us at churchsecondbaptist@gmail.com. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
morning, Second Baptist. It is a pleasure to be here before you this morning, or whatever time you're tuning in with us this morning. We once again welcome you, and we want to say Merry Christmas as we are approaching Christmas this upcoming Friday. We are excited. This is exciting times. It is truly a blessing to be able to bring the good news to you all. And this Christmas season, and as Pastor Sykes would always used to say, that Christmas was a word that would mean more of Christ, Christmas. So more of Christ. We want to remember that as we celebrate Christ, and as we celebrate the birth of Christ and the magnitude of what his life means to us. But we also look forward to this time for the gifts people give. And typically, we are not afraid to open these gifts that people give us because we're excited about the blessings that they are going to be to us. But sometimes in life, God gives us gifts that not only blow your mind, but you become afraid of the gift and all that it entails. So today, I came to encourage you to not be afraid of the gifts that God gives. I came to tell you what the song says, that the gift actually does look good on you. You were born with a grace, and guess what? It looks good on you. It's a divine enablement. The gift looks good on you. And if you work your grace, the grace will work for you. So once again, don't be afraid of the gifts that God gives. If you haven't figured it out by now, my topic this morning is, don't be afraid of the gift. Do not be afraid of the gift. My text is going to come from Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 to 25, and it reads as thus. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done, that it might be fulfilled which is spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and called his name Jesus. May God continue to add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of his precious and holy word. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for this opportunity that we are here to go in depth into your word, this living word that still lives today, Lord, that continues to bring forth life and life more abundantly, Lord, that encourages, that uplifts, Lord, that puts on love into our lives. Lord, it shows us how to love and who is love, because you are love. So, Lord, we just thank you for this love letter today. Lord, we thank you for this Christmas season, even though it may not be the same as it has been in other years. Lord, we are still grateful to be here in the midst of our families, in the midst of others, Lord, whether we're seeing them virtually, Lord, or in person, Lord. We thank you for your protection. We thank you for your covering, Lord. We pray for healing of those that may be sick in this season. We pray for encouragement to those that may be in hospitals during this time. Lord, we pray that you lift up their hands and know that you have never left them nor forsaken them, Lord. We know that you are heal us, Lord. We pray in this season that you will do a healing, a season of healing right now, Lord, that your miracles be wrought and that you will have your way. So, Lord, I pray that you will speak through me, Lord, so that you may increase and that I may decrease in all things. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Yeah. You know, when we hear the beautiful songs that we have that have been shared with us, such as, "Come all ye faithful, holy night, O little town of Bethlehem." When we watch the beautiful renditions that come on TV, how they all come together to bring to life the miracles, the magic, the wonder, the splendor of Christmas. Sharing with us the great story of the Lord's entrance into this world. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the mighty God that was stepped down from eternity, down into time, wrapped himself in flesh, and a choir that was acquired from the dressing room of Mary's womb. And tabernacled amongst men is cause for even angels to celebrate the glory and the presence of God. And because of this great gift that God has given to us, the world stands in awe and the church in splendiferous praise to God, celebrating the gift that he has given us through Jesus Christ. The gift is expressly eternal life. Without his coming into the world, and without him taking on human flesh and becoming kin to me, he could not redeem me as my kinsman redeemer. The ills and the plight of humanity and the consequences of sinful endeavors are all eradicated in the presence of Jesus Christ. For wherever Jesus is, it is heaven there. And whenever Jesus shows up, deliverance is bound to happen. And today we celebrate his entrance into the world. But be careful in all of the splendor, in all of the glitter, in all of the lights, and all of the wonderful things that we do to commemorate the birth of our Lord and Savior, and the depiction of the manger, and all the holy scenes that we have. Be careful to understand that the first Christmas was not as beautiful as the ones that we see today. That the first Christmas was not filled with the splendor, all the wonder, and all the fine foods, and all the wrapping paper that fills our living rooms these years. In fact, some of you thought 2020, we about to have the worst Christmas. I beg to differ when we start looking at the very first Christmas. The first Christmas wasn't filled with all the joy and all the excitement that we may feel right now, particularly in the life of some people who were directly affected by Christ coming into the world. You would think there would be joy, but the reality is, most and generally, with the gifts God gives us, we have joy in retrospect. As we look back at it and see that his plan was actually better than ours. I want to warn you, my brothers and sisters, that initially when God gives you a gift, it does not always evoke joy and praise and splendor. It often comes with confusion, mayhem, and chaos. And you begin to wonder in your own mind whether this is a gift from God or a plot from the enemy to destroy your very life. You would think God that Joseph would be filled with glee and filled with excitement about the birth of Jesus Christ. That God had chosen the woman that Joseph had chosen. He could have said, "I must be all right that I chose the woman that God wants." That God had set her aside even as Joseph had set her aside. That God himself has selected her should have eased his troubled mind as to whether she was a virtuous woman or not. But sometimes, being chosen of God and being selected of God and receiving gifts from God can have a fellow in disarray. And so when we see Joseph, we don't see him dancing. We don't see him celebrating. We don't see him opening up gifts with joy and excitement. We see Joseph worried and upset. Because generally, when God gives you a gift, it often worries you before it blesses you. Oh, let me repeat that again, because you may have missed that while you were stirring up your grits on the stove. And many times when God gives you a gift, it often worries you before it blesses you. Frankly, at the time that Joseph leaps onto these pages of this text that we have read, he is not trying to find a way to get closer to the baby Jesus or the mother who is pregnant with him. No, he is in fact trying to figure out, how can I get out of this mess? Yeah. How can I just quietly and as calmly as possible find my exit route without drawing attention to myself? Just show me the door so that I can exit. Exit stage left, please, so I can get away from this gift. 2020 has exposed many of those that have gifts. It has caused many to be put to the test in using their gifts. Some have excelled and others have backed into the recesses of excuses. These times have caused us to stretch and put us to work mentally and physically. I have seen many thrive and do mighty works for the kingdom in spite of the challenges. And I've also seen many succumb to fear and are paralyzed by the state of an ineffectiveness and filled with excuses. I don't know how to use technology. Well, you've had over 9 months of being stuck in the house in a pandemic, and you still haven't learned how to post one status? Excuse me, excuses come when we are afraid to use our gifts in unusual times. But I came to tell you that we serve a God that is not stopped by anything. We serve a God that allows us to be creative and innovative. He has gifted us to be thinkers and not be confined into a building or a tradition. He has gifted us to never give up on building his kingdom in unity and not just with who we like. God has gifted us for a season like this, but we are like spoiled children that do not like daddy when he changes up things. I want to warn you that many times when God gives you a gift, instead of running towards it, our propensity is to run from it. Because after all, who knows what is in a gift given until it is unwrapped? Perhaps it is not so much the gift that I want to warn you about, because it is God's gifts that will ultimately pay off in the end. Perhaps it's not the gift that I should sound the alarm on, but let me tell you what to watch out for. Perhaps it is the wrapping paper that you gotta be warned about. Because God's greatest gifts are often wrapped in problems. God's greatest gifts are often wrapped in anxiety. God's greatest gifts are often wrapped in worry. God's greatest gifts are often wrapped in chaos. God's gifts often come to us camouflaged in a fine array of disgusting, perilous circumstances that seem surmountable. Great gifts can come wrapped up in being fired from a job. Great gifts can come wrapped up in a package where someone that you thought you could not live without has walked away and left you. In fact, God can give you a gift and you not feel gifted at all. In fact, being gifted can be a problem, because many times when God gives you a gift, people are not happy for you. They don't celebrate the gift God has given you. They don't come to worship the gift. They often come to kill the gift, to destroy the gift. Yeah. So I suggest to you today that we must move beyond the meek and murky borders of just discussing the birth of Jesus Christ from his historical perspectives. As wonderful as it may be, but to extract from the historical illustration some contemporary wisdom that can be used against our challenges today is what makes our faith vibrant and relevant and effective. We didn't just come to commemorate a historical God for something that happened 2,000 years ago. We came to recognize a relevant God who is still affecting change in our contemporary society. The very first thing the angel says to Joseph, to a worried Joseph, is, "Fear not. Fear not." Why does he tell him, "Fear not"? Because fear can paralyze your faith. Fear can limit your perspective. Fear can intimidate you from growth. Fear can cause you to give up on something prematurely, not recognizing that God is not through working his magic and his miracle in the gift that he has given you. Fear can make you give up on something that God is going to bless you with. Fear can can make you put away, as Joseph did, the only redemption that was available to him. He was about to put it away because of fear. Be careful that you do not allow fear to rob you of God's gifts. There are three different types of fear that I believe engulf Joseph's mind, and I want to share them with you today. Not only so that you might have a more interesting understanding of Joseph, and the propensity of the fear over his life, but that you can effectively use them in your own life as God gives you gifts. New jobs that God can give you, new marriages that God can give you, new children, new opportunities, new obstacles, new enemies can all come from these gifts that God gives you. I know that you are used to the traditional gifts that come wrapped in beautiful packages, but not God's gifts. He does not wrap his gifts that way. There are three things that I believe caused Joseph to be entangled in fear and adversity. Number one was the fear of perception. The fear of perception. What will people think about me? How would people feel about me? Often when God gives you a gift, he gives you a gift that causes you to become controversial in the eyes of people. I need to repeat that again. Often when God gives you a gift, he gives you a gift that causes you to be controversial in the eyes of people. And if you were not so gifted, you would not be so hated. If you will notice in our society, we seldom waste hate on people who are not gifted. Think about how many people you hate on. Oh, I forgot, you might not hate on nobody. Think about how many people hate on you for the gifts that you have, because I have to think about it the opposite way, because you know you don't hate on nobody. But people don't waste time hating on people that are not gifted. And if you understand it correctly, it's a privilege to be hated on for his name's sake. It's an honor to be so selected, so chosen, and so gifted that somebody has set a decree to kill. I came to tell you that somebody is on the hit list of hell, but only because you are gifted. Even if you don't receive anything for Christmas, even if you're in a nursing home and no one comes to see you, even if you are a lovely mother and your kids don't recognize you on this Christmas, you are still gifted. You are still gifted with life. You are still gifted with health. You're still gifted with strength. You're still gifted with integrity. You're still gifted with ideas. You're still gifted with concepts. You're still gifted with creative potential. Oh, yes, you are gifted. If you do not allow fear to rob you, fear of perceptions, what will they think? What will they say? What will they do? How will they feel about me? The fear of misperceptions robs us of the gifts that God came to give us.
Yeah.
So on this upcoming Christmas, I would encourage you to shake off fear, off the fear of perceptions. Because if you can shake off the fear of perception on Christmas, then in the new year, you will be ready to receive the abundance. I came to tell you that there is something in the new year that is coming that will justify all that you've been going through. You thought 2020 was something? Wait till 2021. He's going to give you everything that you thought you lost back with abundance. But you can't receive it if you're more concerned about perceptions than you are about receiving the power that God has for you. Number two. I want to warn you about the fear of provisions. The fear of provisions. Can I afford this gift? Can I afford this gift? Do I have what it takes to maintain this gift? I remember when I went out to buy my own car, the one I'm driving now. And I was so excited, but I looked at the price tag and I knew the maintenance on it would be what it would be. But I had a pretty decent job. I got my career path going on and had saved up some money and my credit was on track and doing well. So I saw the car that I wanted and I went to the dealership, but I got nervous and I said, well, I can't buy it until my daddy get off work so he can co-sign on the car to make sure I can get it. So I waited, I was impatient. While I was waiting to test drove the car, I continued to look at the car, checked it out over and over and over. And finally, my father got off work and met me over at the dealership and we sat down and the man ran my credit and he came back and he says, you don't need him to co-sign on this. Credit's good enough, you got enough income coming, you got it on your own. Right then and there, I recognized that sometimes we worry about the cost or what we think we lack when God is saying, I brought you here to enjoy the blessing. Be careful that God doesn't take you to a place of blessings and you're too worried about how much it costs that you can't enjoy the blessing that God has for you.
Right.
I'm not trying to imply that Joseph didn't have all the resources. Obviously, he had enough resources to have a dowry in order to espouse the virgin to be his bride. Obviously, he had enough resources that as they traveled, he and his pregnant fiance moving from place to place, he was not looking for benevolence, he was looking for hotels. You don't look for hotels if you don't have any money. But when you are dealing with provisions, you must understand that sometimes you need provisions that money cannot buy. Oh, when you're dealing with some things in life, there are some things that money cannot buy. Joseph had the money, but the ends were filled. And isn't it frustrating that by the time you realize the money you need for the places you need to go, suddenly you find out that the money is not the only provision that you need to sustain you for where God is taking you.
Right.
In other words, I'm trying to tell you that God can give you some things that money cannot give you. Don't be afraid. Fear not. God already has the provision covered. You are waiting on this stimulus check. Guess what? He already has a place prepared for you. He already has a provision set for you. And when people shut the door on you, it's only a sign that God is about to open another door in your life. Oh, I don't know who I'm speaking to for this Christmas season, but somebody ought to thank God for the short shut doors. He shut doors, guess what, to open new ones. They shut him out. You can't come to this hotel. You can't stay at this motel, Joseph. We're all filled for the night. No vacancies over here. But God has an open door when man closes a door. God opens a door.
Oh, yeah.
To God be the glory for the doors that he opens. I hope there's someone watching online that is believing God for open doors. Oh, I thank him for the open doors that he opens that no man can shut. And he shut doors that no man can open. God will open a door for you, and you do not have to live in fear of somebody shutting the door that God has opened.
Amen.
He said in Revelation, I have set before you an open door. I hope you receive this word that God has set before you. In the coming year, he has set. It is firm. It is concrete. It is anchored. It is unbreakable. It is unreversible. It is unmovable. He has set before you an open door. Do not be afraid of the gifts God gives. It is true that wherever God guides, guess what? He will provide.
Oh, yeah.
Number three, the fear for providence. The fear for providence. Providence is simply God's guidance. The fear, if I go, will you go with me? If I say yes to this new door, Lord, and this new opportunity, and this new direction, if I seize the gift that I used to run from, if I embrace the thing that historically I have been terrified of, I could do it better if I simply knew for sure that you're going to be with me and go with me. I know if you go with me, the storm can break out and the lightning can flash and the thunder can roll and the boat will not sink as long as I understand you are with me, Lord. Maybe I should understand that Christmas looks better in retrospect than it did in reality. And maybe life looks better when you look back at it than it does while you're going through it. And maybe there's someone online that is rejoicing over something that you used to cry about. Maybe it is the retrospect that God calibrates the issues and vicissitudes of life. Maybe it's when we look back at it that we say, you know what? It was good for me that I was afflicted. Because if I didn't go through what I went through, if I had not gone through it, if I had not faced it, if I had not endured it, if I had not been fired, if I had not been rejected, if I had not been turned down, if I had not been ostracized, I would not have found the door that God had in store. In fact, thank you for hating on me. Thank you for leaving me. Thank you for rejecting me. Thank you for disappointing me. Thank you for shutting the door on me. You can't stay here is what you said. You are not welcome here. And I came to tell you, thank you. If you had not done that, I would have never gotten to spend a night in a bar, serenaded by angels, illuminated by stars, and behold the wonderful splendor of his provision. Often, it takes you away, God's gifts often takes you away from normal places. Because where God is going to bless you may be outside the box.
Yeah.
You know that box that you keep trying to put God in? He's actually trying to bless you outside that box. He's trying to bless you outside the system, away from the norm, in a place you never thought a blessing could be. God may bless you in an unlikely place. Don't be afraid of the gifts God gives you. Don't be afraid when he bypasses the hotels and takes you to the barn. Because God has a way of turning a barn into a penthouse suite. Don't be afraid of the gifts God gives. I know it's Christmas season and you're excited about having picked out your pajama sets for when you wake up to open up your gifts and take those nice pictures and what you're going to put on to arrive to the living room for later on. You are excited to open up your gifts and eat the good food that's being cooked and prepared. But I came to tell you, while you are excited about that, God is up to something. In every barn and in every manger, with the mooing of every cow and the gathering of every lamb, in the midst of every gathering of hay, goats, and sheep, God is up to something. Anytime God takes a holy thing and places it into a mundane thing, God is up to something. Whenever God promises to bless you and you start going down instead of up, guess what? God is up to something. Anytime God takes you outside the system, guess what? God is up to something. I hope I'm speaking to someone. God is up to something. Stop being afraid of change. Because whenever God is getting ready to rearrange your life, you have got to open up and say, change what needs to be changed, move whatever needs to be moved, shake whatever needs to be shaken. I am available to you. I trust you. I'm going to open up this gift. I'm going to take it by faith, and I'm going to look into it and see what's inside. Fear not, Joseph. Fear not. Calm down, Joseph. That's what he's saying. Calm down. You are so troubled that you are worried even in your sleep. And God said, in fact, I had to speak to you in your dreams because when you are awake, you are so worried you are not listening to me. Many of you worry about, I can't hear God. God don't speak. Because you are talking so much in your head to yourself. You don't have leave room for here to hear God. And so God said, so I had to invade the only space left available where I could speak to you, Joseph. When you finally give up on your thoughts long enough to hear my thoughts, I spoke to you in the night because you were not listening in the light. Fear not, Joseph. Church, God is saying, fear not. The Lord is with you. Here are a few takeaway points that I want to get out to you in this text. He says, fear not, Joseph. That is in Mary has been conceived by the Holy Ghost. What he is saying, stop worrying about how things are going to turn out. Because whatever God starts, guess what? God has to finish it. I want you to get the beauty in this. You see that was in Mary, Joseph. You didn't start that. So therefore, you didn't have to finish it. God said, I started that. So I will finish that. To every person, this is on a new adventure that is intimidating, that is terrifying, that got you all upset. As long as you didn't start it, you don't have to worry about finishing it. He that hath began a good thing or a good work in you shall perform it unto the day of who? Jesus Christ. I feel that it's going to be all right. Why? Because he is Alpha and Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He is the first and the last. If God starts it, he will finish it. And you need to say right now in your living room, finish it, Lord. But this second point really captivated me. For in the text it says, even after Joseph woke up, he walked with his bride Mary for 9 months, never consummating his marriage with her. Just walking beside the woman he loved, that he espoused, that he married, but he didn't touch. What is God trying to tell us here? Don't touch things while God is working on them. God is saying, don't touch things while God is working on them. God is saying, while he is working, we must be still and allow God to be God. Yeah. Do you remember Uzzah? When David was bringing back the Ark of the Covenant, and Uzzah reached out and touched it, and the Bible says that Uzzah died? God is saying, tell my people, don't touch my stuff. When I'm working it out, don't call anybody, don't write anybody, be still. This may not be the Christmas message you were looking for, but God is telling someone right now, don't touch it. God is not finished with it yet. Do not touch it. It is still up under construction. Don't touch it. It is still up under development. Do not touch it. Jesus will remind us of this point again when he rose from the dead. And Mary, in her excitement, got ready to reach out and touch him. And Jesus says, touch me not. Yeah. Some of you may be thinking about that song, touch me not. And he says, touch me not, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. For everyone that is on their way up, you must say, touch me not. In other words, don't put your hands on me. I'm on my way up. I can feel a change and a break in a day. The third takeaway I want you to have is that God does not wait for people to reject you to have a place prepared for you. He already had the manger in place. While man was shutting doors, God already had a place set up for you. Your mission, should you accept it, is to find the place that God has for you. The Bible says that when he found the place, and the Virgin Mary got ready to birth the child, they were looking for something to put the baby in. The horses had nothing, the sheep had nothing, the goats had nothing, but over by the cows, where the women have been milking the cows, there were some rags that we call swaddling clothes. And these swaddling clothes are milk rags. They catch the milk. And so they took the milk rags and wrapped them around the baby Jesus. And it was appropriate that he should be dressed in milk rags because he is the milk of the word. And when they took the milk rags and wrapped it around the milk of the word, all the animals stopped. And the stars began to shine, and the heavens opened up, and the wise men pulled up and said, this is the place. I want to tell somebody that has been wondering how to fit in, where to fit in, and do I belong? I want to tell you that this is the place. This is the place where the magic and the miracles happen. This is the place where God turns things around. And this is the place that no weapon formed against you shall be able to prosper. Outside of this place, of the secret place, they were trying to kill the baby Jesus. But inside of this place, he that dwelleth on the inside of the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. He is the only reason that you are still here today in 2020. Today, because you have found the place where the wicked shall cease from troubling and the weary shall be at rest, and all the saints of the ages shall sit at his feet and be blessed. Every gift that God gave me scared me to death. He called me to do this, and it scared me to death. He called me to do that, and guess what? It scared me to death. He called me to leave the comfortable to go into the uncomfortable, and guess what? It scared me to death. I am a living witness. Don't be afraid of the gifts that God gives. It may scare you. It may truly indeed be very, very terrifying. But I came to tell you today, don't be afraid of the gifts that God gives. Because what God wants you to do is to trust him, to obey him, to not worry about him. Because he's going to take care of everything that you need him to take care of. I come today as a messenger to you. I come to you to give you the word of truth. A word to a worried generation. Fear not. The Lord is with you. And he will always continue to be with you. That what is in you is conceived by the Holy Ghost. Take your hands off of it and let God handle it. He that has begun a good work in you shall complete it to the day of Jesus Christ. When you have it, wrap it up in the word of God. Because all those things that will try to put out the word, the enemy can never kill. From the throne of God to the lips of man, Merry Christmas to you. I know that this is Christmas season, and it is time of fun and laughter, but I want to do something important today. If you are watching this now, and things are not right between you and God, whether that means that you have never given your life over to Christ, or that you have at some point have given your life but you have strayed away so far and you want to come back home, now is the time to receive him into your life. This is not about reindeer. It's not about the snowman. It's not about Santa Claus. Why don't you make a decision to give your life to Christ today? To right now. The tree that I'm talking about is the tree of life. And the gift that ought to be up under that tree is you. Why don't you bring your gift and put it under the tree of life and let it work for you? Pray this prayer with me. Lord, I now recognize that Christmas is all about you and more about you, Christ. Lord, I understand that you came into this world as a gift for me. Not to run away from you, Lord, but to run to you, Lord. That you are ready to catch me in your arms, Lord. So, Lord, I thank you, Lord, for this gift that may be camouflaged in pain, this gift that may be camouflaged in agony, this gift that may be camouflaged in suffering, and even in death, just for me. You did something you did not have to do by dying on a rugged cross. But because you love me, you paid the ultimate sacrifice of dying for my sins. And for this, I accept you, Jesus, as my Lord and Savior. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. If you prayed that prayer today, you're already saved. I pray that it continues to bless you, Lord. That as you continue to bless the Lord, I pray it blesses you. That you may understand that God is always making ways out of no way. We encourage you to write to us. Especially if you have questions and you want to understand more how to join the church and how to participate and how to become involved even in this virtual world. Feel free to email us at churchsecondbaptist@gmail.com or even call the church even Monday through Friday. We have a secretary here always from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. You also can call on this Sunday. We're going to start having a one-hour phone line for individuals to call in if you need prayer. Or if you just want to state that you have been saved and you've been blessed by this service. So continue to be blessed. Continue to follow Christ. As always, keep your eyes on him. Tis the season to be jolly. Tis the season to love. Because Christ is love. God bless you. Love you, church.